हाँ। अरे मैंने कल वीडियो जो अपलोड किया यूट्यूब में अपना
इट इज
सेशन।
शोइंग, वी आर लाइव ऑन यूट्यूब, इट इज कनेक्टेड सर,
ओके ग्रेट, चलो
1 मिनट, इट इज सेटिंग अप मीटिंग, 1 मिनट।
राजू मैं रिकॉर्डिंग करूं?
हाँ। अरे मैंने कल वीडियो जो अपलोड किया
इट इज शोइंग वी आर लाइव ऑन यूट्यूब,
ओके ग्रेट, हेलो
1 मिनट, इट इज सेटिंग अप मीटिंग, 1 मिनट।
राजू मैं रिकॉर्डिंग करूं?
यस सर।
Raju miss, please send the link to circulate.
Raju, मुझे recording का permission दो ना।
हाँ sir, एक मिनट।
Raju miss, please send the link to circulate.
PC को दे दो Raju, PC को recording का permission दे दो।
Recording का permission दो।
हाँ सर, एक मिनट, एक मिनट सर।
बीसी को देखो राजू।
हाँ 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 सर, एक मिनट। हाँ सर, एक मिनट।
We can start now.
Sir, it's got connected to YouTube.
Yes, yes.
YouTube से हो गया connect sir?
Yes, we are live now.
Okay, so Inchira, this is your screen, right? Okay. Thank
ma'am.
You. Thanks all. Thanks everyone. It is 11:01. Okay.
We can start now.
Sir, it's got connected to YouTube.
Yes, yes.
YouTube से हो गया connect sir?
Yes, we are live now.
Okay, so Inchira, this is your screen, right? Okay. Thanks,
ma'am.
Thanks all. Thanks. A very warm welcome to one and all today morning. We welcome you all to this webinar on Instructional Strategies of Robert Manzano by Professor Sheetal Chhabria. Active learning is effective learning. We all know that. And it's become all the more important to have various learning strategies as we deal with the virtual teaching in the current times. Therefore, we have this webinar, keeping in mind the needs of the hour, we have the webinar themed around Instructional Strategies of Robert Manzano by Professor Sheetal Chhabria. May I request Inchira Sheikh to please play the prayer. We begin our session today with the prayer. Inchira?
Hold on, I will start the prayer.
Thank you, Ranjit sir, for playing the prayer. And I now request upon Dr. Bhagwan Balani to give the welcome address to our audience today morning. Thank you. Over to you, Dr. Balani. May I request Dr. Balani to please welcome the audience?
Yes, Ms. Sapna. Good morning to one and all. Respected Dr. Ritu Upal, respected Dr. Meenakshilal, respected Dr. Mandeep Kochar, and all my dear colleagues from Bombay Teachers Training College. Now we have met the tradition of organizing webinars on very important topics in academics. The purpose of organizing these webinars is to enhance the professional repertoire of educationists with a very special reference to as far as emerging educationists are concerned and all of the student teachers studying in B.Ed, D.L.Ed, ECP, and all our alumni are the emerging educationist. So we want our students to take a very active part as far as these professional endeavors are concerned. And when they will pass out from this college, we will wish that they shall continue this journey by indulging in professional activities and keep on upgrading their repertoire wherever they are placed. Another purpose of organizing this webinar is to help them to understand, to learn from senior faculty members about the instructional techniques and the strategies that can be used very effectively by them in the classrooms. And for that, we have been collaborating, associating ourselves with the experts from the field. And we want to create a learning community which shares, which believes in exchanging their ideas, their strategies, their methods to reach out to the larger community. And I believe that we have started communicating, we have started understanding one another, and we have also started using digital platforms to reach out to one and all. Ms. Sheetal Chabria is a very inspiring teacher to me. She has been talking to me long, and we were organizing, we were thinking.
उसका नाम नहीं है कहीं हरीश चाकिया का. हरीश चाकिया ये मतलब भी कोई और चाकिया है.
राजू मैम प्लीज म्यूट रुक्साना's आईफोन. वी वर टॉकिंग, वी वर प्लानिंग टू organize one session, and even we are also planning to start a certificate course in educational leadership. She's an expert, and I'm highly inspired by the way she's committed to the field of education. So I'm fortunate that she's there with us as an educationist, and we all are looking forward to learn from her, and I will wish that she in future also she becomes a part of the BTTC family, because the kind of bond that we have created, relationship that we enjoy at BTTC, she shall be also a part of BTTC family. So I welcome Miss Professor Sheetal Chabria to BTTC family. And I wanted to introduce her to the faculty and the students, and we are looking forward to learn from you. Another thing is that Dr. Ritu Upal is also a very promising tech savvy teacher. She's a resource person. She has created a lot of online resources, and she has got her own expertise in the field of educational technology, her PhD in education technology, and she's also a resource person to various professional bodies. And I will wish that she shall also come on this platform, introduce herself, speak with the faculty and the students. And we are also looking forward to learn a lot about higher education from her. So, my dear students, we are in good number, 74. This is a truly an inspiring morning for all of us. And we all are keen to learn more about the instructional strategies which has been proposed by Robert Marzino through Sheetal Shabria. And I'm also quite happy that Ms. Sapna Shabria has emerged as a very active professor at Bombay Teachers Training College. She has played a very significant role in collaborating, in connecting with the students and the faculty of B.Ed. And she has a truly an inspiring, we can say, teacher for all of us. So I'm thankful to Sapna Shabria for taking this initiative. And I will wish that she shall continue in undertaking such type of endeavors. And let us to be together and enjoy this morning from morning to, we can say, afternoon till 1 o'clock, and learn together from this webinar series. Over to Ms. Sapna Chabria.
Thank you very much, Dr. Balani, for the kind words. And at BTTC, we don't have an option but to be very inspiring and to be ever growing and upskilling ourselves under your able guidance. Thank you very much, sir. And sir, I just want to be sure, do we have Dr. Ritu Uppal in our midst?
Yes, we do.
We are very lucky this morning to have in our midst Dr. Ritu Uppal, and she is the chief guest for this event. May I now call upon Dr. Neelu Verma to formally welcome our chief guest, Dr. Ritu Uppal, today. Over to you, Dr. Neelu Verma.
Thank you, Sapna. I feel extremely delighted this morning to welcome our mates, Dr. Ritu Uppal. I have had the good fortune of being in her company for a few days while I was doing a course, and I learned a lot with her. Quoting about a few, summarizing about her achievements, what else can I say about her other than the very, very fact that she is an extremely achievement-driven professional, and she targets challenging assignments as academic lead for technology-led courses. She is a MOOC expert. She is a change manage consultant, educational technologist, a content manager, a teacher trainer at heart, a program leader in many upcoming programs, online learning specialist, also an e-learning consultant. With over 30 years of experience in academic consultancy, in change management, in instructional designing, curriculum development, content writing, reviewing, managing and delivering, mapping of objectives and evaluations, detailed instructional planning, session planning, innovative and interactive teaching ideas and strategies. I feel so happy having you amidst us. She has also been nominated and working currently as a mentor for Open Education for Better World, that is O4BW project of UNESCO chair, Slovenia, in collaboration with University of Nova Gorica, Slovenia. Ma'am, as I said, is a teacher educator at heart, and she is a certified Cambridge PDQ program leader to train Cambridge school teachers as per the Cambridge standards. She conducts workshops for higher education and also for school teachers all over India, teaching lots of ICT tools, research methodologies, designing and developing MOOCs, flipped classrooms, open source learning tools, storyboarding, instructional designing models like ADDIE and Dick and Carrie model. Believe me, whatever we are trying to learn these days, Madam is already a pro in all of that. If students, you try, if you're listening to me, whatever you are trying to learn in the last few months because of the lockdown and the situation has compelled you to do so, Madam has already tried all of that in the last so many years, 30 years of her experience, and she's wonderful and amazing, amazingly expert in all of those technologies. She's also a founder member of MET, Center of Educational Technology, Metrishipul. With a very humble heart, we welcome you, Dr. Ritupal, and we sincerely hope that with you, we also learn at least a little bit of the technology, at least those drops in the ocean, which you can share with us. Thank you so much for being here this morning. Thank you so much. We welcome you, Dr. Ritupal. Over to you,
Ms. Namaskar. Hi, and I'm very, very happy to be able to reach out to so many eager learners. And as I would say that this is the first step towards educational technology. Education we have been doing for so long and we are pros at it. Now the challenge is how to use technology in education. My journey into educational technology started in the year 2005 when I joined SNET University to do master's in educational technology. After that, I have completed my PhD under Professor Vasubasudha Kamath, the then Vice Chancellor of SNET and presently member of Kasturi Rangan Committee, who has written the present educational policy. So whatever new is going to come, we have been practicing for the past 15 years, basically. So I've been teaching, as she said, I've been training teachers. And let me see, I have seen change. 2005, when I started teaching, training teachers, we used to start, you know, from where, how teachers used to ask, alag-alag login kyun hota hai? So I used to tell them ki alag-alag login isliye hota hai, aapke alag-alag bank account hote hai na, waise alag-alag login aur password hota hai. So this is how the journey started. And now I see there is lot of difference, lot of change, positive change that too, because teachers are taking technology very, very seriously now, because now change is inevitable. Whatever has come is going to stay. So we have to keep in mind that we have to make our session interactive, and an excellent model is you are being taught now. You also must read, you sir must have included Ganey's 9 events of learning. And as in Cambridge and IB boards we see, and international education if we see, is that students are expected to be reflective practitioner. So all the models which promote reflective reflection as a very important tool for self-development, those models and those techniques and strategies of teaching and learning need to be integrated in our teaching learning environment. So for the students to be reflective practitioners, first it is the teachers who need to put in some reflection on how we are teaching, how we are integrating technology, how are we making the environment, learning environment pro for the students. If we are speaking continuously for 10 minutes, are the learners there with us? So in an online environment, this becomes a challenge. So how do we address those challenges? First of all, as Neelu ma'am said, lot of ICT tools need to be integrated in our teaching pedagogy. But only thing is that since time is limited for shifting from face-to-face to online, and now if we tell them, Sara, start using pedagogy or online pedagogy completely, it will take time. So we can take baby steps. It's okay. We are teachers. We are not gods that in a jiffy we become pros in educational technology. But we need to take baby steps towards integrating lot of tools. There are many tools available for recalling, many tools available for making our content interesting. There are extremely good tools for summarization, for formative assessment. Many teachers feel that there is a challenge for online assessment, let me tell you, there are about 12 to 15 very extremely good tools. There must be 50 tools, but 15 tools are extremely good. And you need to be little creative. If you use those tools creatively, the same tool can be used for 5 different purposes. But take up any 5 tools, what I would suggest. Take up any 5 tools and be practice those tools. As you start practicing those tools, you will feel that, अरे इसको मैं यहाँ पर भी use कर सकती हूँ, इसको मैं यहाँ भी use कर सकती हूँ. Something like a concept map. A concept map, if you start learning how to create good concept map, you can use concept map for recall of the previous session. You can use concept map for teaching. You can also use concept map for formative assessment. You can also use concept map for summarization. So there is no need that you need to know 15, 20 tools, because it is not necessary. So just try, take up 2-3 tools in the beginning and 5 tools by the year end. If you do, your technology challenges will be overcome for sure. So this is what I would suggest, and keep on reading and practicing and be motivated yourself. If we are motivated, our passion, our body language shows everything we already know as teachers. So I give the session to our main speaker, and I would like to thank BTTC College Professor Balani for giving me this opportunity to interact with you, to reach out to you. I hope we have many more interactions. Thank you.
Ma'am,
have any question? Yeah.
Like I have always read that technology gives even the quietest students a voice.
And yes.
This is what the current times have actually proven this to us. So we are sure to learn from you and from others, all those technological tools which are going to help our teachers, our upcoming teachers, to be successful in the classroom. Thank you so much, ma'am. Over to Sapna, ma'am.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ritu Uppal, for that very vibrant speech.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for inspiring all of us. Great.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Neelu Varma, for introducing our chief guest today morning. And now may I call upon Sadhav Jaipurwala from SYDLA to formally introduce our resource person for which we are waiting for a very long time now to know more about instructional strategies of Robert Marzano. Over to you, Ms. Sadhav Jaipurwala, for introducing our resource person, Professor Sheetal Chhabria. Sadhav, Ms. Sadhav.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Begin, Sadhav.
Good morning to one and all. I, Chaturwala, take this opportunity to welcome everyone to today's session. It is my true privilege to introduce our resource person for today, Ms. Sheetal Chhabria, who will enlighten us about the instructional strategies of researcher Robert J. Marzano in education. Ms. Chhabria has completed her master's in education management from Essendity University. She has also done her postgraduate diploma in pre-primary teacher training. Ma'am has also done 2 research papers on topics such as the study of teachers' understanding of character education and a study on the effect of parent interaction on child behavior. She has worked with Tata Institute of Social Science, also worked as a curriculum developer, conducted various workshops, worked as a teacher in Kangaroo Kids 2. Currently, ma'am is working as a visiting faculty in Essendity University and has a personal endeavor known as Shaping Intellect, where she conducts workshops for educators. Ma'am, we are truly privileged to have you here with us on this virtual platform. Now I request Ms. Sapna Chhabria, ma'am, to take the proceeding further. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sadhav. for introducing our resource person for today's webinar. And over to you, Professor Sheetal Chhabria, for beginning the session on instructional strategies. Thank you. Over to you, Ms. Sheetal Chhabria.
Very good morning to everybody at BTTC. And I would like to thank Professor Balani, Professor Sapna, and everybody at the BTTC team for having me on this platform. Dr. Ritu Uppal, it's really nice to have you here. So thank you for being with us and investing your time at this webinar. Let's begin with our presentation. Sir, it says host disabled participant screen sharing.
Ma'am, I'm making you the co-host. Just a moment.
Yes.
Please check now, ma'am.
Yes, it's fine. Thank you so much. So we begin with instructional strategies of Dr. Robert Marzano. Before we move on to the instructional strategies, let us understand who is Dr. Robert Marzano. Dr. Robert Marzano has contributed a lot to the education sector. One of his most important domains for teacher improvement is classroom strategies and behavior. Dr. Marzano's instructional framework provides teachers and administrators with research-based resources for providing quality instruction while also taking into account the needs and abilities of individual students. He has worked towards converting the art of teaching to science of teaching. Generally, we all say teaching is an art, but he has given us research-based evidences wherein the art of teaching is now a science of teaching. The goal of his research is to make teachers as effective as possible by providing proven instructional strategies. So this is about Dr. Robert Marzano. Now let us understand what are the 9 instructional strategies and how do these practices, they help us increase student achievements. I would just like to say, if anybody has questions, we can discuss this at the end of the presentation, please. The first strategy is identifying similarities and differences. Now, when we say identifying similarities and differences, it simply involves identifying how items, events, processes and concepts are similar or different based on their characteristics. Why is identifying similarities and differences important? It is important because the ability to break a concept into similar and dissimilar characteristics allows the students to understand and often solve complex problems by analyzing them in a more simpler way. So when we give complex problems to the students, instead of just saying this is a new problem which you have to solve, if we can connect it to the previous knowledge what they have, if we could discuss the similarities and differences of what they already know and what they are going to know, that is how it helps. Like you see in the Venn diagram, which is on the screen, we are discussing about whales and fishes. So an initial level, we teach children what is fishes. When we move on to discussing whales, like you see in the center, we have written what are the common factors between whales and fishes, and then we have gone on to understand the differences. Now, why is this similarity and differences at with higher age students? We can also use things like what is similar in the story, what was similar in the previous chapter, what is it that you know, and what is it that you have learned new. Let us understand what are the examples which we can use to implement this strategy. Examples are concept search, variations of Venn diagram, like you can see. Now, compare and contrast can happen with summaries, with narratives. We have comparison matrix. A very simple example which comes in my mind, when we are very young children, don't we have that game where we say, circle the similarities, what is similar in the two pictures? That is how we begin at the initial stage, and we can move on with complex diagrams like the Venn diagrams as we address to the older age group. Let us go to the next point. Summarizing and note-taking. Summarizing and note-taking, it is, when we speak about it, the general thing which comes in the mind is what to delete, what information to delete. But summarizing and note-taking, it decides on which part of materials are important, where it requires rewording, what part of material should be prioritized. Generally, when we speak about summarizing and note-taking, the teachers lay emphasis or the students lay emphasis on kya delete karna hai. We don't have to focus on what we have to delete. Instead, we need to focus on what is important and note it in a and make notes accordingly. Moving on, when summarizing, a teacher can ask students to ask questions such as what is unclear, or and clarify those questions. And then she can predict what is going to happen next. Researches and studies show that the more notes we take, the better it is. The more information we have on hand, it is better for future reference. As a teacher, we should encourage and give time for review and revision of notes, as notes can be the best study guides for future. Now, what happens is generally we say, you know, we will speak about summarizing, we will speak about note taking, but our classroom plans are so, you know, so overpacked that we don't give it time. So to make this and to implement this strategy more effectively, we should keep good time in hand for children to make notes and then probably refer to it and ask questions. The reason why Dr. Robert Marzano has listed down these strategies is to make the classroom more engaging for the students. The students should be engaged so effectively that there is no scope for them to get distracted. Let us understand what are the examples of implementing summarizing and note taking. We have comprehension, mind mapping, like you can see in the image, the box and bullet method, reflect and self-assess completed questions. The self-assessment is also a very important part. So while summarizing and note-taking, after they have done that, we also should encourage students to, you know, go through their notes and probably understand if they've got the concept, they've got a very clear understanding of the concept. Moving on to the next point. Reinforcing effort and providing recognition. Very simple point. It is nothing very difficult. Like you see in the images, reinforcing and recognition is a very simple thing which we do, but which is often neglected. When we have a large number of students, or when we are overburdened in our classroom with a lot of topics to cover, the recognition part goes for a toss. We generally point out where the students are wrong, what mistakes they have committed, and we often neglect the recognition part. It is very important. Recognition is a personal praise or gratitude for good work, and it can be given at any time, while rewards are more goal oriented. All right. So simple things like if students are, you know, well mannered, or they are well groomed in the class, a simple recognition like we appreciate their behavior is important. While as for reinforcing effort, it goes like, if you complete this task, you are going to be achieving this. So it's like, if you finish your maths problem in 5 minutes, we are going to appreciate that. You will probably be the next maths monitor in the class. So things like this is very important. Reinforcing refers to teacher's acknowledgement to a student for a specific accomplishment. It is very important that the teacher should show the connection between efforts and achievement. It should not happen that you are talking about maths problem and you have promised that one who does the maths problem, solves the maths problem first, is going to become the monitor. But suddenly you notice that somebody is behaving well and you decide, okay, fine, you were quiet in the class, so now you are the monitor. You cannot go back on your word. Once promised, please stick to it. We should use symbolic recognition rather than tangible awards. it is also important that though not all students realize the importance of effort, but we can work towards changing their beliefs to emphasize on these efforts. Let us understand simple examples for implementing reinforced effort and providing recognition. Credits, wall of fame, peer tutoring. Peer tutoring is a very wonderful way of encouraging students. It's always like when the students are told to teach their peers or they are asked to play a role of a teacher or explain a particular concept, it gives them great happiness. It gives them a sense of pride that they can do what the teacher can do. So reinforcing effort and provide recognition goes a long way. Homework and practice. Homework and practice, it's generally when the term homework comes, the students are like, oh no, we have to do homework. And teachers are like, oh no, we have to give them homework. But no, it's not the case. Homework and practices are very important because it helps us, it helps the student to get more better. It helps them to get closer to perfection. Homework provides students with the opportunity to extend their learning outside the classroom. Now, it is very important that as a teacher, we should explain the purpose of the homework to the student or and the parent or the guardian. Sometimes what happens is the parents or the guardians or the caretakers of the children do not understand the purpose of the homework. It often happens with me. If my child will come and say, I have to make this assignment, the first question is, which subject? The second question, what is the purpose? So if parents are well communicated and well informed about the purpose of the homework, the impact is better. Again, the homework which is being given to the students should be debriefed, should have minimum involvement of parents, and should state the purpose. Once the students have a clear idea of why the homework is given or why is it important to practice, they are more efficient at doing it. They do it more happily. Practice also helps in improving the speed and accuracy. We should remember as teachers that both homework and practice should provide students with chances to deepen their understanding and the skills. It should not be that it's just a repetition of what is happening in the classroom. We should remember to give them homework, which can be a little challenging, but yet in line with what has been already done in the classroom. So it will encourage them to research, it will encourage them to think and then come up with answers. Certain examples are simple MCQs and timed quiz, practice books and worksheets, student homework log and assignments. These are certain things which we can use to implement the strategy of homework and practice. Moving on to the next topic. A very important one is non-linguistic representation. Non-linguistic representation helps us throughout our life. Like you see in the image, it's just a representation which says that we should save water. Why should we teach non-linguistic representation? Now this is because knowledge is stored in two forms, linguistic and visual. The more students are, the more the students use both these forms, the more they are shown, the more they are taught by using both the verbal and the visual forms, they understand better. So if everything you, like you see, you know, if you explain something with a small cartoon image, or if you explain certain items with drawings or with mind maps or with graphs, it's easier and faster to connect to. Unless if you go on speaking, it's a simple thing. If you are speaking about, for example, Shivaji Maharaj, children will connect better to it if they have a picture of Shivaji Maharaj in front of him. If you go on speaking, okay, once upon a time we had Shivaji Maharaj and he did this, and it doesn't help. So if we could have pictures while speaking about the person, it really helps. Students should create graphic representations, models, mental pictures, drawings, pictograph, and participate in kinesthetic activity in order to assimilate knowledge. Use of non-linguistic representation is very important because it has proven to not only stimulate, but also increase the brain activity. When we try to create non-linguistic representation, or when we refer to a non-linguistic representation, it stimulates our thinking. Like if you look at this image, you will think about what it is. Is it just a tap being sad and happy, or is it about the water flowing? At different levels, at different ages, people have different perception. Non-linguistic representation is very important throughout our life, because when we travel to countries where we don't speak their language, there are these pictures which tell us, which guide us to the way. We can refer to those signboards on the road. We can refer to the signboards at the airport as to where the water tap is, where the washroom is, where do we have to go, which door we have to go. So the no honking sign, the upslope sign while driving, all these are examples of non-linguistic representations, and they are very important. So it is very important as a teacher that we encourage these non-linguistic representations. We can also, instead of asking them to write answers, sometimes we can ask them to draw the image. I had this wonderful experience, which I want to share with you. I was dealing with a 5-year-old boy who was just learning how to write spelling. So, at the age of 5 years, you are just learning 3-letter words, can, at, bat, like that. He was watching something on the YouTube where they were telling them how to make some craft out of a balloon. So when the instructor was telling them, okay, now I'm going to tell you the list of materials required, she went on telling things like scissor, glue, balloon, watercolors. Very interesting was the child didn't know to write, but he drew everything. He drew his representation of this is like, this is balloon, the glue, the scissor, and later on came up and explained, yes, I know how to do this activity. See, I have drawn everything, and went on to explain the requirement for that activity. So this is how non-linguistic representation goes a long way. Certain examples are graphic organizers, physical models, mental pictures. Like we say, imagine that with the older students, we can use, they need not necessarily make an image or draw an image. You can just say take 2 minutes and imagine that you are on a top of a mountain, or imagine that you are in a country where you don't know to speak the language. How would you do? Things like drawing pictures and pictographs, human graph, these are all examples of non-linguistic representations. Moving ahead, cooperative learning among students. Like you see, the image says, get along with each other, respect everyone's opinion, offer support and ideas, use soft voices, participate actively, and stay together as a team. When it comes to teachers to encourage cooperative learning, it is very difficult. Generally, the teachers don't want to do that because everybody has got different ideas, but it is a very important aspect, right? Organizing students into cooperative group yields a positive effect on overall learning. Teachers should limit the ability of groups, keep groups small, apply strategy consistently, and do not overuse. So not all projects can be given for group. We can have small number group with small number of students, and we can give limited projects as group activity. While giving group activities, we also have to keep in mind that how feasible it is for the students. For example, if somebody is staying in South Bombay and the other person is on the north part of Bombay, you cannot expect them that they will come together and prepare a chart for the classroom. It's not really practical, right? However, if it is an online presentation or something, or making a PowerPoint presentation, it is possible because they can share their data through emails and club it together. So these kind of small things, we have to really keep it in mind, because this goes a long way when it comes to cooperative learning. Also an important, while grouping students, we have to keep in mind considering a variety of criteria, such as common experiences or interest. Like I said, as a teacher, it is very difficult to do that. But yes, to an extent, when we are looking at a, probably that group project is for some out of school event or something, it is very important to see if the students have some common interest. Otherwise, it is going to reflect and create a negative image for the school. Once again, vary the group of sizes and objectives, and we should focus on the components of cooperative learning. Cooperative learning is also very important because it helps enhance the students' social skills. Social skills is required not just at school level, but at every level. Even when we are working, even if we are dealing with our family members, our friends, our social skills go a long way. So cooperative learning among students is, I wouldn't say we just have to keep it to student level, but we as teachers also have to, you know, we have to emphasize that it goes a long way throughout the life. It's more of a life skill. Certain examples are group discussions and debates where we generally have a lot of people. A wonderful activity called Stump Your Partner. We have case studies. And when we go down to preschool level, we have dice games and jigsaw puzzles. See, as teachers, when I'm speaking to teachers and when I'm speaking about these things, the general thing is, this teacher, this ma'am is speaking about these, but how would we implement it? But when you read the terms, for example, when you're reading cooperative learning among students, go down to the lowest level possible, go down to the level of a preschooler. How would you do that with them? Then move on to your students. What happens is generally when we say cooperative learning and you think about college students, oh my God, how are we going to bring this group of boys together to work? Why not? They have to sooner or later learn this, right? So we have to first be confident about what we are going to do and then bring it up to our students. Next point, setting objectives and providing feedback. Very, very important again. Setting objectives, it generally provides students with a direction for their learning. Like you see, today you are at this level. You will learn this by doing this activity so that you can achieve this target. And you will know you have got this, achieved the targets when you see the following results. So setting objectives and in the end, the feedback which will assure that you have achieved your objective correctly. The objectives which or the goals which are set for the students, they should be easily adaptable by students. It should not be very difficult. It should be very specific so that the students know what goal they will achieve and what kind of feedback they are looking forward to. As a teacher, we have to make sure that the feedback is corrective in nature. We need to tell students how they did in relation to the topic, how they did in relation to specific levels of knowledge. This is very important again, because both objectives and feedbacks, this gives students the direction and helps them to reflect on their learning. Once the students get a proper feedback from the teachers, they know where did they go wrong and where they can improve. Again, a very important thing is when teachers are told to provide feedback, if the number of students is large, it becomes very difficult. But yes, we can always give feedbacks like most of you have done this point very effectively and maybe we can improve on these points. So a general feedback also works very beautifully at times, but a feedback from the teacher is very, very important and it goes a long way. A little motivation from the teacher that my teacher told me that I am good. A beautiful example which comes in my mind is there was this little girl whose parents always told her that she's good at drawing, but she had this big time inferiority that she cannot draw well. Okay, no matter how much the parents told her that no, you're good at drawing, it didn't work. Till one day she drew something and the teacher told her, this is very good. You've done a very good job. And she was very, very happy to get that feedback from a teacher. Why? Because the teacher is an outsider. She's not living in the family. So she knows that the teacher cannot be biased. She cannot be influenced by her parents. She's giving an honest feedback. So the feedback given by the teachers go a long way. Let's look at some examples of how we can do. For setting objectives, we can have things like lesson plans. For providing feedback, we can have results and reporting, certificates and rewards. We can have rubrics, different ways to give feedback. Sometimes a verbal statement is enough and the student, it works marvelously. Going to the next point, generating and testing hypotheses. So yes, when we speak about hypothesis, the only thing that comes in my mind is, oh my God, this is for research. This is for PhD. This is for doctorate level. No, it doesn't happen that way. Simple things like you see, the W's and the H on the screen, the who, what, where, when, why, how. These are the things which help us, these questions, they help us to reach the hypothesis. Now, when students generate and test hypotheses, they are applying their knowledge, okay? This task of generating and testing hypotheses generates questions and hypotheses. It encourages students to think what may work, what may not work. Basically, it is simply asking students to explain what they think according to them is going to happen. Simple example, like if, for example, now the situation of this COVID, right? We can ask the students, what do they think if this COVID goes on for a long time? how do they, you know, intend to continue their education or continue with the online education, you know, how do they intend to probably gain more knowledge? Maybe probably how do they intend to do their physical training classes online? Okay. Again, we can have questions like, what would you do if you were the king of that, if you were the king at that time, if you were the king of that country, or if you were in that particular situation? What would, simple examples would be, predict what would happen if an aspect of a familiar system were changed. Like, what would happen if the government changed? What would happen if the new education policy is implemented? What would you do if you were left alone in your house and you're without your parents? How would you deal? You know, what would you do if suddenly a guest comes home and you don't know to cook? Simple things. These are day-to-day things which help children encourage to think. You know, we encourage children to think. Also, an important point of generating and testing hypotheses is build something using limited resources. The reuse, the recycle factor, it is very, very important. If you see in a classroom, if they have a free creativity class, for example, and you give 5 children 5 empty bottles of water, the plastic Bisleri bottle, and ask them to make things out of it. Don't give them any ideas. Just let them be and tell them create something out of it. And it is a beautiful experience. You will see how different children come up with different things they can use, different ways in which they can use that simple plastic bottle. So this, in this way, we are teaching them manipulations with resources available. So generating and testing hypotheses is not just for the research and doctorate level. It starts from a very basic level of preschool and goes on at different levels. The levels of generating and testing hypothesis changes with the age group of the students. The last one, questions, cues, and advanced organization. So what, while asking questions, teachers have to focus more on higher level questions. We have to allow for the time to allow the time for students to think and get back to us, get come up with an answer. It should not be that I give you question after question and I'm not waiting for the students to answer. It doesn't work that way. Cues are generally reminders or hints about what students are about to experience probably, or a purpose to trigger their memory. Like, we had, remember what we did in the last class, how are we, so we are how we are taking the last class lesson ahead. And advanced organization is a frame, advanced organizers is a framework given to given prior to teaching a new content. It is basically more like a timetable what we share with our students. Now, why are these question cues and advanced organizers important? Well, it is very important because these tools help students use what they already know about the topic and how they can enhance it further. These tools should be highly analytical, should focus on what is important, and are most effective when presented before a learning experience. So generally, giving you a simple example, if we are talking about animals, so when we start with the at a preschool level, when we start about animals, we speak about, for example, what animals we have in the forest. Once you talk about lion, tiger, elephant, for example, and then when you have the next class, you will probably speak about their children, about what is the young one of the lion called, what is the young one of an elephant called. And then you can also move on about, can we tame these animals? How can we, is elephant, can we, you know, tame an elephant, and how can we probably use that elephant, right? Although it's not very advisable to tame these animals, but this is how it is. We can go from step A to step B to step C. So this is about previous knowledge and implementing the new knowledge. Let us look at some examples. The KWL charts, which is already knowing what we want to know and what we have learned. Again, the concept search of compare and contrast, like what we had done earlier and what we are going to do. A dictionary is a good example of cues. You can learn different synonyms for a particular word. While implementing the session of question cues and advanced organizers, we generally encourage on picking up an idea, organizing and generating notes for that idea, and asking students to give their opinion, their feedback, their perceptions about what they have understood. So these are the 9 instructional strategies by Dr. Robert Marzano. These 9 instructional strategies, I would say, are important because they provide a structure. They provide a structure right at the beginning for how we want to implement a new strategy. And many of these are also life skills. They show the value of each in and out of the classroom. And it emphasizes that we remember we focus on quality and not quantity. Like you see, identifying similarities and differences, if we see, it is an important life skill because it is going to help us, probably manipulate with the resources available. Summarizing and note-taking is always important when we are attending meetings, when we are watching activities on YouTube, when we are probably even watching recipes. If we can quickly note down what we want to do, it always helps. Reinforcing effort and providing recognition always goes a long way, be it a friend, be it a family member, be it a student, be it an colleague in the organization. If a little bit of effort, if a little bit of recognition is given, it always makes relationships stronger. Practice doesn't only come to the student level, it is also important for adults, because only if we practice, we get better. And with every practice, there is something new to learn. Non-linguistic representations, I always said it is important. I already said it is very important because we need to understand how to read the signs and symbols while driving, while traveling. Cooperative learning is again a very important life skill because we have to deal with different kind of people at various levels of life. Not everybody is going to agree with us. So we also, as teachers, have to focus on training children to disagree, but respectfully. Objectives and providing feedback is very important. Again, if we have our objectives, we know in what direction we have to go. So it does not end at a school level, even as an adult. Once we know our objectives, we can set our priorities and we can work in that. Generating and testing hypotheses is more like reflecting. When we are dealing with the older students, it is more about reflecting on what they have done. And if we have cues and advanced organizers, we always can work in a right direction. We don't have complications. We don't have confusions about what should we do, what we shouldn't do. So this is about the 9 instructional strategies by Dr. Robert Marzano. These are not just instructional strategies. These are more like life skills. But in my opinion, all these strategies are very important. But as a teacher, the most important thing is flexibility. So sometimes we may plan a lot of events, things. We may plan that we are going to teach in this strategy and that strategy, but the students are not in that frame of mind. So we have to change. So flexibility is very important. So with this quote, that sometimes the things your students need the most has nothing to do with what's on your lesson plan. Every teacher should be flexible. She cannot be rigid with her ideas. We come to the end of the presentation. So with this, we come to the end of the presentation. I would request Ms. Sapna to please take over.
Thank you very much, Professor Sheetal Chhabria. I would like you to elaborate on the instructional strategies. That was your second last slide, and with the illustrations for each one. So that will be great if you would give us an example of each one.
The instructional strategies, the second last slide was a brief. I mean, I had just put all the strategies which I have discussed from the very beginning together.
Yeah,
right?
So I would prefer if you would give us some more examples, and you had some really good examples and illustrations of the real life situations. So more of that would definitely be a good option today.
Okay, so we will take it point by point. We will discuss a few examples.
Yes, that will be nice. Yeah.
Yes.
Especially if they are, the real life examples rather than that one can do that or this. So that will be really nice. Thank you.
Yes. So when we discuss about identifying similarities and differences, I'll share an example of drawing class where the child was supposed to use the color blue. Okay. Now every school, they teach them primary colors, secondary colors. So it is not very surprising if the child says we can mix 2 colors and get a shade of blue or something. But what was interesting here is that the child had seen her mother use the food color blue, because she was baking some cake or something, and she had seen how the mother was using the color blue. When this child sat to do her painting, she realized that she didn't have the color blue. So she identified that the paint color could be similar to the food color, because both have the properties. They both are changing the color of the object, right? So she went on to ask her mother, can I use the food color instead of making a color or getting another color? And can I still complete my picture? The mother was very impressed, and of course she allowed, and of course the job was done. Now, this is a very small basic example which I'm sharing, but this is how we can encourage the children to think. All the activities of Dr. Marzano is with the simple intention of keeping the students engaged in the classroom. So if you allow these kind of things, their thinking skills improve and they are more curious, they want to learn more, and they are more engaged with us. When we come about summarizing and note-taking, so two students attending a class and both of them taking notes. One has written down points which have to be deleted. Ye important nahi tha, ye important nahi tha, this was not important, this was not important. The other person has written down what was important. Which of these notes would be better? It would always be better to refer to the notes of what is important, because the number of material, the quality of material, what we will get from there is always going to be better. So it is very important that we tell students to focus on what is important rather than what is not important. Of course, deletion is important. We need to, know what points we don't need to lay emphasis on. But if we start on a negative note, that negative thing builds up. Summarizing and note-taking is quite similar to selective listening. You know, when you're getting five instructions from five different people, you pick up what is important and you do that. Or when somebody is going on speaking something which is very irrelevant, you probably don't pay attention at all. You are saying, you're responding, yes, 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 but you're not paying attention at all, right? So this is like summarizing and note-taking. Reinforcing effort and providing recognition, it is a life skill, because I know of people who come up and say, no matter what I do, my mother's never going to be happy. No matter what I do, my husband is never going to be happy. Why? The mother's very happy and proud of the child. When you speak separately to the mother, she says, nobody has a child like me. My child is the best. But there is a lack of communication. She's never gone up to the child and said, oh, wow, you're doing well. And you ask the mother, why haven't you ever said this? Why haven't you ever expressed your feeling? And the mother will say, this will probably spoil the child. It's not going to spoil the child. Because you have never expressed, the child has developed an attitude that she doesn't want to do anything more to impress you. So recognition, providing recognition, appreciating the child is very, very important. Homework and practice, when we come to these points, what happens is sometimes when students don't do correctly in the class, the other day I was attending a class where the child was constantly writing the spelling wrong. It was an online class, the teacher can't really do much about it. So it was very nice when the teacher said, I like you have tried, you have finished your work, but you know what, the spelling is wrong. So it requires more practice. And the immediate reaction from the student was, teacher, I don't want to write. Okay, you don't write. Maybe you can practice it at home and show it to me tomorrow. Simple. Teacher, I don't want to write at home. Oh, you don't want to write at home. But then how are you going to remember the right spelling? If you don't remember the right spelling, how are you going to read your storybooks? Will it not make life difficult for you? Simple things like this, and the child understands the importance of practice. Parents can also, do simple things like, I don't know the spelling of this letter. Maybe you can teach, so this word, and maybe you can teach me what is the spelling of these words. So these are the ways where we can inculcate the habit of practice to the students. When we come to the next non-linguistic representation, like I said, we need to know to read the signs and symbols, very, very important. Personal experience, when I was traveling abroad, I was at the Frankfurt airport for some time, and I realized the people are only speaking German there, and I didn't know to speak German. So yes, I was, relying totally on the signboards as to where I have to go, what I have to do. If from those young age, if we encourage children to understand, it goes a long way. You know, we have something called the picture talks. You just show a random picture, probably of a boy fishing. And then we have those closed questions and open questions where we ask, what do you think the child is doing? Is he fishing? Okay, fine. The picture clearly shows that the boy is fishing. So the next would be, what do you think, you know, the child will, the boy will do after he catches the fish? So this encourages thinking. The next, what is next? And it also encourages the child to pay attention to the things on in the picture. So if somebody might just say that the boy is just thinking, the other person who noticed it correctly said the boy is sitting and trying to catch a fish. He is sitting still because he's trying to catch a fish. So these kind of non-linguistic representations, they encourage thinking. Cooperative learning is always working in group, team spirit, team leadership, team efforts. All this comes under cooperative learning. Again, this goes a very long way. Objectives and feedbacks is always very important nowadays, specifically when we have a lot in our hands to, you know, accomplish. If we set our goals and objectives at the beginning of the day, at the beginning of the week, we know what tasks have to be accomplished. It definitely makes our life simpler. Generating and testing hypotheses. You know, when we are teaching students, we should use the deductive approach. So how can I explain? Yeah, with an example, if I want to explain. Dolphins are mammals and all mammals have kidneys. So all dolphins have kidneys. You getting it? The deductive approach. So we refer to a general rule to make it a prediction. If we begin like this, the students will understand. We can use this like, you know, all green vegetables are good for eyes. So probably if you are not having, you don't like the taste of fenugreek, maybe you can use spinach, right? Things like this. Question cues and advance organizers. We should, you know, when we are using this strategy, we should follow the questions and, or, you know, we should give cues in such a way that we can reach the different, achieve the different levels of Bloom's taxonomy. We can, you know, as a teacher, we should be able to understand what the student has understood about the concept, how the student remembers. Will the student be able to create something new out of the knowledge what the student has received? You know, it would be like when we generally speak of a particular topic. For example, you discussed roses in your classroom and you ask the children, what do they know about roses? So everybody will say, we know red, yellow, blue roses are, red and yellow roses are available. And somebody comes up and says, why don't we have a black rose? All right. So this becomes a thing. You have already given them a cue that the roses are available in different colors. Now this becomes a research topic. Okay, maybe you can go and find out whether we have black rose or we don't have black rose. And this gives children an idea that what would be discussed in the next class. So in these ways, all these nine instructional strategies, I wouldn't say we can restrict it to just students, but even as adults, if we keep this in mind, it goes a long way. So yes, Sapna ma'am, I hope I have clarified it.
Yes, very well. And now it's time for the question and answers. Can we take up some questions from the audience now?
Yes, sure.
Okay. Well, you know, there have been various compliments for you and audience has liked your presentation. Some of them are saying that very clearly in the chat. You can also see. It's a very good presentation, ma'am. And one of our participants wants to know that, you know, what are some of the strategies that a teacher, an educator can use in case of students who are not doing as well as the other students? You know, we usually use the word weak or below average, but let's not use those words. Let's put it in a more positive way, as in we're not doing as well as the others. So yes, you know, what's some very, very specific strategy if you would like to suggest today, or give some specific example whereby a particular strategy has really motivated a child who was not doing well, and we saw a very huge improvement after the application of that strategy.
Yes. Thank you. So for the, you know, in case you're addressing to a student and you particularly are addressing to a student who's not doing very well, what is important as a teacher is first to understand what is the learning style of the student. Once you know what is the learning style, what is his intelligence? For this, you know, we have Dr. Howard Gardner's multiple intelligences. What is his learning style? What is his intelligence? You can probably start explaining the concepts in those ways. And that is how you can improve the students, gain the students' attention. A very good example which comes is I was in one of the rural schools, and I was very amazed how everybody in that school was very fond of subject history. Now, history does not really attract all students. For some students, it's very boring because it has a lot of facts and data which need to be correct. You cannot just frame up anything. So I came to know that the professor there was, you know, he was very fond of writing poetry. So the professor went out of the way and he, you know, wrote poetries on all the important facts from each chapter. And that throughout the history syllabus was taught in a poetic way. Now for the children, this was something very different. I mean, till last year you are learning history with, this is the date of when the person was born, this is the date when he achieved so-and-so. And suddenly you have somebody in front of you who's singing a song, okay? So it was a very different thing. And the children were doing very well in history. So this is one example. So we need to understand what is the learning style of the student. Yes, ma'am?
Okay, yeah. So I hope Miss Kavita Chandra, who had put this question, you know, got the answer. And we all also, you know, learned through your example how this can be done very well. And apart from that, how can we motivate the least interested students of the class and who, you know, seem to be paying no attention to the lecture and the instructions given by the teacher? This is a question from Dr. Saroj Pandey.
The most effective way of dealing with this is make the child the monitor. Announce it that this particular child, after I finish the lecture, this child is very intelligent. So he or she is going to come up on the dais and give us some notes or some pointers about what the teacher has taught. This works effectively 99% of the times. We have tried it with various students at various levels, ma'am.
That works by making that person monitor. But, you know, by making that person monitor, can one be pretty sure that I know he'll assume a new role now. I know he's going to feel more important. Maybe he was feeling neglected. But do you think it has a direct relation, or have you seen, a direct connection between giving him this kind of responsibility, which is essentially a non-academic type, like, you know, being a monitor is not purely academic. So do you also see a better performance in the academics of these children also?
Yes, because it serves two purposes. One, you are giving the child the responsibility. So the child knows that she has to come up on the dais and explain. So generally, they don't want to be made fun of. They don't want to be ridiculed. So they pay more attention. Second, it helps the teacher a long way, because teacher understands that in spite of paying attention, the student is not able to understand the concept. So now it is up to the teacher. How would you change your teaching strategy to implement it to the student, to make the student understand? So it goes two ways. Most of the time, children's attention span is limited, or when they come from home, they carry their baggage, or there are different things. But when you tell them that you have to do peer tutoring, then you have to come up and speak about it, that responsibility or that sense of pride, they pay a lot of attention and it works. And if it is not working, then again, it is teacher's responsibility to understand. Probably the child has a different learning style, and then we can change our or give a little more attention to the child, or give a little more time to the child and explain, if possible, in their learning style way.
Sheetal.
Yes, sir.
I was continuously listening to you, each and every word, and I have gone through the presentation. Was truly a logical sequence with wonderful pictures and
thank you so much.
And even explanation illustrations are quite appropriate. I'm very happy that it went very smoothly. Now, if you look at as far as contemporary challenges are concerned, my question to you is that how we can engage the children digitally, whereas we can use Robert Marzano's instructional strategies. How we can do this now? This everything that you explained was in the classroom. Now, when you are at a distant place, how these children can be engaged?
Well, when we are having online classes, we have to keep we have to conduct the classes in such a way that we can have children's attention, students' attention constantly. So it cannot happen like now we were adults and on this platform, I was not asking anybody any questions. I was going on. But usually even when I am conducting, you know, a smaller group and we have webinars, we keep them asking questions. It's not one way. The communication should always be two ways. So for example, when I'm talking about the instructional strategies, when I say identifying similarities and differences, I will probably want the students to come back with answers. What comes into their mind when we speak about similarities and differences? So that way, when a teacher is conducting any class, before she moves to the topic, questions like, do you remember what we did last time? What do you think? Or probably show a picture and ask, what do you think we are going to do today? Take frequent breaks and ask questions. It should not be one-way communication. And random selection. So probably, you know, okay, you will take a name of a child and you answer this question. Okay, Sheetal, you answer this question. Okay, Ekta, you answer this question. So things like this, when you take individual's name and randomly ask questions at random times, it should not be a fixed schedule. The student knows ki the next part is going to be question answer. So when they randomly ask questions, we do have children, we have noticed that students do pay a lot of attention. Yes. Sir, you are on mute, sir.
Yes. So that is one of the strategies that you interact with them. You give them some assignments. You ask them to do something and share it with you. Now, do you think that which group fits into this system the best? Maybe pre-primary, primary, secondary, higher secondary. Which group do you think that can be engaged?
Sir, everybody, because when you're dealing with pre-primary students, they are given simple, when you ask them simple questions, they are already very excited to, you know, see themselves on the screen and answering. So it works very well for pre-primary. At secondary levels, children are very naughty. They know that they can, you know, mute themselves and turn off the camera and probably play a video game. But if you randomly ask somebody's name and ask a question, the student knows ki this professor is randomly going to ask questions. So I have to be more attentive. And I wouldn't say in a negative way, but in a firm way, the teacher can point out that because you're not able to answer, probably you were not paying attention. So in 99% of the cases, this random questioning, random giving them tasks, it works, it goes a long way.
But you mentioned that we shall promote collaborative learning.
Collaborative learning, sir, on a digital platform, it is effective when you give them some group projects, which they have to come back and get back to us on the following day or things like that. Immediately in the on a digital platform, then maybe you can take names of 8 students and tell them to think about particular topic and make another team B and ask them to talk. And then you have to give them chance, like let the team A talk one by one and let the team B talk one by one. So things like this work.
Okay. So may I ask one question now, sir?
Yes, please.
All right. So, you know, we would like you to throw some light on, you know, the strategies that we can use in the online teaching. Because now, while, you know, we all have got our, you know, skills updated as far as using the various devices and the platforms is concerned. But, you know, the strategizing and making sure that the students are engaged in the online instructions and that the learning outcomes are there and the educational objectives are well achieved. you know, it's still a pretty much big challenge. So can you throw some light on the strategy specific to the online teaching for the students?
For online teaching, the best strategy is to ask questions, random questions to students at random time. No fixed schedule ki after this particular lecture she's going to ask. During the lecture, during the thing, ask questions to the students. Make the sessions interactive. It should never be that you're giving a presentation and the students have an option of probably, you know, muting themselves and switching off the camera and just enjoying themselves while you're presenting. It should never be like that. If possible, it is always advisable to keep the video on so they are engaged, they know that the teacher is watching. And also, you know, somewhere statements like, you know, I know my students are paying attention. If you keep on repeating, if you keep on you know, saying things like this, it helps because students get that feeling. Somewhere the conscious says, ki my teacher has faith in me. So these kind of, to develop this kind of faith and all, of course, we have the value education where students can be honest with us and all. But on a digital platform, if you ask random questions, you give them assignments. If they are short assignments, probably during the lesson. So like I'm giving you 5 minutes, I've explained this, 5 minutes, make a mind map and share it with me. So we know whether the student has paid attention or not. So in these ways, small ways of asking questions, giving random assignments to be, you know, the random assignments to be submitted immediately, given feedback immediately. These are the things which help in the online education. Yes.
One of the students, one of the participants, I'm sorry about that, from Ashraf Reshamwala, the question is, how can we shape the primary level students in online teaching? I think once again, you know, we are talking about the effectiveness. Like, well, you know, most of the teachers, are very, very effective. And over the years, with our experience, we become very effective in actually making sure that the learning outcomes are achieved. But, now with the online, once again, you know, the question revolves around that how can we shape the primary level students in online teaching? Like, make sure, like, can you share some more illustrations with that? Besides, you know, the monitoring, of making sure that they do their assignments on time and, you know, actively engaging in the class. So, you know, yeah, a little more about online teaching.
See, in online teaching, it is it's actually very unfortunate that the teacher cannot individually attend to every student, right? So what we can do is I have seen teachers working like that. Besides engaging them, trying to keep their attention span with us and all that, we can give them certain homeworks and practices, but we have to give topics which are relevant and which are easy. Targets which are easy for them to achieve. We can also have, if possible, we can have a time where they can, showcase their work. So instead of just saying that we are going to do lessons and lessons and lessons, what they have learned out of those lessons, maybe they can make non-linguistic representation of that lesson and maybe they can come up and speak about it. So this again is, it's referring to two strategies of Dr. Marzano. We are referring to non-linguistic representation and we are referring to homework and practice, but clubbing it together. So generally what happens is when we have a classroom session going on and we are, for example, speaking about history, we cannot immediately ask the children, okay, draw. You know, that we are in a very serious mode where we are having a question answer session where we are, but maybe at the end of the session, tomorrow, you students don't have any homework. It's very simple. Just draw what you have learned today. Simple things like this. So, you know, they want to showcase their work or probably make a model and show it on the class and speak about it, speak about the work you have done. So these things, they do go a long way. It's very challenging for the teachers, I understand. But then this is the new way. We all have to get used to it. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, that was very well answered. And thank you very much, Ms. Sheetal Chhabria, for answering the questions that participants had today. And any more questions from the participants? And sir, can we go ahead with the proceedings?
Yes, Sheetal. I think the ideas that you are sharing are quite relevant and are going to help our student teachers to be more effective than they when they will teach either online, either in the classroom. So BTTC students are normally do very well. But now again, there is one question which comes in my mind, which keeps revolving in my mind, which I would like to share it with you. Now we have got variety of schools in our surrounding. There are SEC board school, ICC board schools, and IB schools and international schools are also there. And the effectiveness of school education is considered different. We know that IB schools are doing very well in comparison to SEC board schools. So I would like to know from you what kind of strategies that we need to use to make the Indian schools more creative, and then how can we make students to be reflective learners with the help of this Robert Marzano's instructional strategies. If you can share some of ideas.
Sir, Robert Marzano's instruction.
Or any other strategy that will also be.
Yes. So, see, Dr. Marzano's strategies can be implemented in any kind of board. It's not restricted to IB board or SSE board. When we speak about how we can improvise our education system, just the other day we had a webinar on comparison of Indian education system with foreign education system. So, sir, what we have understood is from that comparison, which I had last week, we are focusing more on theoretical approaches. We are focusing more on rote learning. We are focusing more on grades, marks. You have to study Hindi because you have to pass in Hindi. Now that child is doing beautifully in English, but I have to score well in Hindi. We don't tell the child that you have to learn Hindi because you are living in India where the national language is Hindi, where you can speak to anybody. Even in South, where they speak a lot of South, we will probably go and say, Pani chahiye, dosa chahiye, that person is going to understand. So we don't lay emphasis on the practical use of whatever we are studying. We are only referring, we are laying a lot of focus on theoretical knowledge. Why? Because we want marks. So it's like a circle that has happened. You have to study, you have to rote learn, you have to study, you have to score well, you have to get into a good college, get a particular job. Where are you giving the child the scope to think? If somebody is doing, I mean, now the parents and teachers, of course, the new parents, new teachers have a very broad horizon. They do encourage. We have researches like of Dr. Gardner's where we speak about various intelligences. But earlier it was very restricted. We could not. I mean, everybody wanted to become a doctor, engineer, or a businessman, or a CA. What are the other scopes? What about an artist? What about a musician? Do we ever speak about why is it important? Why do we need musicians in our life? Or why do we need artists in our life? Do we encourage the children to aesthetically, appreciate things? These things, unfortunately, are not very active in the Indian education system, but slowly and gradually, I do notice a change. The teachers are changing, the students are changing. Teachers are playing a very important role in convincing the parents that it is okay if your child wants to become a musician. It is okay if a child wants to become a sportsman. Earlier, these things were very limited. Oh, sportsman, you only have to be a rich child's son to become a sportsman. So these kind of things, the lack, and also one very important factor why the Indian education system is lacking to a certain extent is we do not have secure job options, right? When you do a degree from anywhere abroad the world, you know, in India, people have the mentality, ek degree foreign se kar lo, aapka idhar career set ho gaya. Why? Why don't we give chances to our Indian students? They don't lack anything. They are very good. If that person is going abroad and doing fantastically, I'm sure that person will do very well in India. But our evaluation systems, our thinking, the pressures we have from the family, all these things, they really are like a hindrance to the development of the Indian education system. But of course, with the new education policy and the people with access to more options, more teaching strategies, more learning strategies, I'm sure we are already seeing a little change in this.
Good, very good. I think the perspective that you have given us. So we are changing. See, but as far as the speed of change is concerned, or the pace of the change is concerned, may be slow. But I think we need to expedite that, and we need to move from academics to the experiential learning, which you said. And another thing which I have experienced through the research definitely, that we don't give much emphasis to the co-scholastic program of the school education is concerned, where children are highly engaged in cultural activities and sports, yes, as you rightly identified. These are also the domains where a lot of personal development can take place. So we need to analyze the school curriculum. We need to, as you rightly identified, that open it up. It should be choice-based.
Yes,
we should not, we should not, we can say, impose our own ideas, our own subjects on the students, whether they like it or don't like it. If they don't like it, we should not tell them that you have to learn this or learn that. Whatever the language that they find suitable to them, they shall speak it. And we shall create spaces for that, which you have rightly identified. So we need to be more flexible, more liberal, yes, in designing the curriculum, in offering the choices. And even as far as individual attention is concerned, the parents' involvement is concerned, even I think is very, very low from our side. Even the dialogue between the parents and the student is not up to the mark. So we also need to have a very meaningful dialogue. And the mechanism which can help the parents to understand as far as the development and progression of the child is concerned. So I believe that this is also one of the areas where we need to work very, very hard.
So what happens is, you know, it's very, I don't know what word to use, but yes, in the teaching field, what happens is when a teacher is speaking, or at this generally happens at higher level of education, not at the basic level. When we speak, when we are probably teaching the management students, or we are training the teachers generally have this thing in mind where they use, you know, big terms, terminology which the child has, with the student probably hasn't come through. So I'll give you a simple example. When I was speaking to somebody who's not from an academic field, who's not an in the education industry, and I said that, I told that person that we have a webinar on Dr. Marzano's instructional strategy. Bahut bhari topic ho gaya. So I went on to say, it's not difficult, it's very simple. These are day-to-day things which we do. So when we are addressing to the students, when we are addressing to the parents, instead of using the terms like, you know, the strategy or Dr. Marzano's strategy, if we explain, we are going to speak something about training the teachers, about the techniques we can use. I'm not saying anything wrong. I'm conveying the same message, but I'm at the same time grabbing the attention. Simple things like, I remember this, you know, it's a very funny incident, but it happened. There was this person I know, and she was suffering from a stomach infection, a minor stomach infection. So all she needed, you know, somebody went and told her, "Ki, why don't you try taking the Indian Ayurvedic thing called Isabgol, which everybody knows." Now that person was like, "Isabgol, I don't take all that." So I told that same person, I said, "Go and ask her, why don't you try taking psyllium husk?" She went and said, "Why don't you try taking psyllium husk?" And that caught that person's attention, and she started paying, "Oh, what is psyllium husk? What is it?" And then in the end, we told her it is Isabgol. So we have to understand who we are addressing to. If we are addressing to people, may keep things simple. And if there are people who only understand that high language, use that language for them. We cannot use the same language for everybody. So if we keep things simple, we get the attention, and then we can use the technical terms, we can use the higher terms, especially while interacting with parents. Yes.
I'm very happy that a very healthy discussion is going on and ideas are being exchanged. But now the ideas are being exchanged by a few individuals, and on this platform, we have got 85 participants. Now I will request all of you, please switch on your videos and start contributing, adding yes and can be done now, especially BTTC faculty. Ambika is also there with us. Raju ma'am is there. Please contribute. Ritu ma'am, what is your view about the interaction which we had right now?
Very, very fruitful. I was doing my work also, and I was listening to Sheetal ma'am's
extremely well presented session. It shows the lot of experience she has. Sorry, there is a lot of light. I'm working in my office, so not ideal conditions. The questions put up by the participants and thought-provoking questions put up by Balani sir. What we feel the lead of the hour is individual learning through group learning, which I would always suggest to all the teachers who are practicing. So what is the in thing is that every student has to learn through a community of learning. So that it is a duty of a teacher to create an environment which is student learner friendly, a non-threatening environment. Very often when I'm seeing on internet, when teachers are teaching, still we are using same language which we used in classroom. We show our eyes, we put our fingers like this and talk to the children. And gone are the days, this was the time jab hamare time mein ye chalta tha, ab nahi chalta hai. So with time we need to change, and especially when you are on online, the teacher has to grasp the attention of the learner. For grasping the attention of the learner, I normally have to say, market yourself well. So be polite, be little friendly. I include little humor in your teaching and learning. And for the holistic, as a national education policy nowadays is saying that parents play a very important role, which Professor Balani also said, parents. What has happened nowadays is, when I was also teaching 15, 20 years back, I was a teacher, and I always used to say that teachers are second mothers, because parents are spending less time with the children and mothers more, and teachers are spending more time. But what has happened now is that due to sanitization of the school environment, we are not allowed to touch students, we are not allowed to say anything, because mental, physical, all kind of abuses have appeared in the last 15 years. So there are positives and negatives of this, and I feel that there are lots of negatives. When I was a teacher, we used to just give a nice hug to the child when he would come crying to us, which I think now the teachers are not allowed to touch the child. But I think we can say a few soothing words to the children. So besides content, what I always feel, the personality of a teacher matters a lot. So let the children like you. If remember your bachpan. हमारे को जब अपनी टीचर पसंद थी ना, तो हमको सब्जेक्ट भी अच्छा लगता था. जो टीचर पसंद नहीं होती थी, वो सब्जेक्ट भी अच्छा नहीं लगता. सो व्हाट आई बेसिकली से, द चाइल्ड हैज टू लाइक यू. इफ यू कीप ऑन क्रिएटिंग अ आइडियल लर्निंग एनवायरनमेंट विद सिट एंड स्टैंड बिहेवियरिस्टिक वे ऑफ लर्निंग, वी आर फार अवे फ्रॉम इट नाउ. सो टीचर स्टूडेंट्स आर नॉट द वे, नॉट बीइंग ब्रॉट अप द वे वी वर ब्रॉट अप, वेयर इट वॉज अ वेरी पेट्रियार्कल वे ऑफ ब्रिंगिंग इट अप. So that has to come up in our way of teaching and learning, which will take some time, because we are used to chalk and talk here. And when it comes to online, especially when we are, I really empathize with all the teachers, because helicopter parents are also hovering around when we are teaching. So besides our content, we have to also pay attention to our language, our mannerisms, everything. So kindly keep that in mind, but do not let it hamper your self-esteem, as I would like to say. You are excellent teachers. Only thing is, the medium has changed, and everybody knows that we all are struggling, and teachers all over the world are struggling. So it is, we are at the same platform. So that is what I am saying. So please keep on doing good work, and 84 of you are there to learn, which is a big step. And that means you are ready to learn. Yes, so that I feel is the biggest thing. When you are ready to accept the change, 80% of the job is done. So once ye acceptance aa gaya ki mujhe ye seekhna hai, mujhe ye karna hai, that is the first step and the most important step of our life. Since we have teachers have taken this, there is no end to it. Our children do best in the world. The best CEOs of the world are Indians. So there is something inherently right in our education system. Only naye zamane ke hisab se apni isko nayi bottle mein dalna hai. That's all I normally say. A new bottle has come, so we have to fill it in a new bottle, repackage it and sell it again to our children. So in marketing strategy, we have to market our education in a in a new method. That's all. That's all, Professor Balani. I thought, let me add a few words.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you for your inspiring words. So many more CEOs are there with us, and probably they will be the future entrepreneurs and, you know, will create space for themselves in the world of education. Today, Baiju is dominating the market as far as educational company is concerned. Tomorrow, there will be one teacher from BTDC.
Why not?
Maybe after 10 to 15 years. So let us hope that our students take the right cues from this session and start working in the right direction. Now we have got Ambika Motwani. I would like to invite her to share her, experiences with us. Impressions about this session with us. Over to Ambika.
Good afternoon, sir, and thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak over here right now. And I wanted to add a few words on what you had asked the question or to Sheetal ma'am regarding the education system, like the SSC board is not doing much, but the IB boards and other international boards are doing very, very good. So even when I was a student, when I was studying, we had always been encouraged that, you know, focus on your marks, and there were very limited resources then. And I feel it's even still now because of the stereotypical thinking that, you know, if you have this particular marks, you will get admission in science college, you will get admission into commerce. But we had never got that broadened horizons of, you know, what if you take arts and you can pursue different subjects. So that was a scenario even with our schools. But these days, IB schools are doing it more because I have a friend of mine who has completed her education from IB board. So she was telling me that since 8th standard, they were encouraged to pursue any particular subject that they liked. And she pursued arts. And now she's into her FYBA and she's going to pursue in some mass media thing. So that was the thing which I really liked the most about, you know, encouraging about whatever we find interesting in, rather than just being focused on marks, like you both said, and even I agree to that. So that's what I wanted to say.
Thank you, Ambika. Thank you for being there, sharing your views and impressions. Now, Sheetal, this is your first interaction with BTTC faculty and the students. I would like to know what is going on in you. What do you feel about as far as these moments are concerned? If you can share some of your, experiences or impression about this session.
So first and foremost, a big thank you to all of you for giving me this platform. And it's been a very nice and a very cooperative, session, because I got a lot of support from you, sir. I got a lot of support from Sapna, ma'am. You all have been very friendly. And at every step, I noticed that BTTC is always, ready to help, give guidance. It's not that if you are stuck at one point, you are like, oh my God, you all are always working as a team to find solutions, to absorb people and work together as a team. So I really like that spirit where each one of you is trying to make the other person comfortable and work together as a team. So that was a very lovely experience which I had, yes. So thank you so much for that.
Thank you, Sheetal. Being with BTTC family, with the students, motivating, encouraging, helping. Wow, great. It was a wonderful experience with you. God bless you.
Thank
Please
you,
be there with us. Yeah. Be a part of the BTTC family. Please associate yourself to this larger family and let us learn from one another. We are co-passengers. Life is a journey. Let us learn from one another. Now over to Sapna. Sapna, please now.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much, sir. And yes, definitely this was a very enjoyable session. There was a lot of learning. There was a lot of sharing of, experiences, illustrations, examples. And I thank you, of course, the resource person, Professor Sheetal Chhabria, but also I thank you, the thanks to Dr. Ritu Uppal and also Ambika for sharing the, you know, your illustrations and experiences with us and the real life situations. And yes, indeed, you know, to summarize this session, we learned about the instructional strategies specific to what Mr. Robert Mazzano has said. But apart from that, you know, we with the examples and with the questions that we got from our wonderful audience, there was this question and a very healthy question and answer session, which brought about, you know, a lot of new insight into the lot of, you know, situations that we face in the classroom, the challenges we have, the challenges we might have in the future, the need for the change. And definitely a very, very enjoyable session and a great learning that has taken place. And now, as I was looking at the some of the feedback that the audience, you know, puts in the chats, it is, sir, there is a compliment for BTTC. And that is that Ms. Kavita Chandra says that you all always arrange very nice and informative sessions. So it's a compliment to you, sir, and to the BTTC staff. That, you know, we are known for, you know, organizing sessions which are very, very current, the contemporary and informative. And we are so happy to know that our audience benefits from these sessions. Yes, thank you all. Thank you for supporting us. Thank you for joining us. And we will continue to provide, you know, we'll continue to come up with the newer sessions, you know, whereby the entire community of educators and the staff and the administrative staff that works with the educational institutions continues to benefit from our sessions. Thank you very much. Your feedback really matters to us. And there's also a compliment, Sheetal ma'am, for you. And it's like, you know, there should be teachers like you. And, you know, and therefore, you know, with this kind of approach, with this kind of mindset, and I think, you know, this also extends to the, you know, the other speakers, you know, who joined in the presentation. That is once again, Dr. Ritu and Ambika. And, you know, it's like, if with this kind of modern mindset, you know, not forgetting our roots, essentially, we know how important our heritage and culture is, and we should always be proud of that. And through various examples, you know, all our speakers today have, you know, reiterated that. But also there is a need for change. As we say that, you know, sky is a limit for the growth and development. So let us also accept that sky is also the limit for improvisation. And, you know, that day is not far when our learning outcomes will be huge and when all our educational objectives will be achieved, not in case of some students, but all students. And what we will notice is a very, very, you know, healthy world environment. And, you know, this is definitely going to take us to the concept of the world peace also. And so on this note, I would, one can go on with the positive words and one can really go on with, you know, these appreciation and compliments, which is coming from the bottom of my heart about today's session. It was, you know, some of us may feel that we know it all, but it's so important to constantly remind ourselves, okay? And, you know, and also, you know, if you look at our audience demographics today, we have our students there. We have students of all the three courses. We have our alumni students over there. So, you know, and for many of the students, for many of our participants today, this is absolutely a new knowledge. And for us, the experienced educators, you know, this kind of constant reminding definitely helps us. And, you know, we get encouraged, we get energized. Thank you once again. On that note, I would invite our student of SYDLED, Ms. Arfia Pavaskar, to propose a formal word of thanks. And may I now request our student from SYDLED, Ms. Inshira Sheikh, to also share the PPT slides as Ms. Arfia proposes the word of thanks. Over to you, Inshira and Arfia.
Thank you, ma'am. A very good afternoon to one and all. I feel privileged to get this opportunity to propose the formal word of thanks on this occasion. Thank you is the least I can say to you to show my appreciation for everything. On behalf of entire BTTC family, I thank our resource person, Ms. Sheetal Chhabria ma'am, on sharing the different instructional strategies which can make teaching learning experience better and ensure learning outcome. Sharing real-life examples and illustrations of classroom situations made your presentation interesting. Thank you once again, ma'am. Thank you, Dr. Neelu Verma, ma'am, for introducing our chief guest, Dr. Ritu Upal, ma'am. Ma'am, we have gained knowledge about do's and don'ts that a teacher needs to keep in mind always, the changes we need to incorporate with changing time. Ma'am, we thank you for gracing our event today with your inspiring speech. I express my gratitude to the in-charge principal, Dr. Bhagwan Balani, sir, and in-charge vice principal, Dr. Mandeep Kochar, ma'am, to provide me with this opportunity. An event of this nature wouldn't be possible without the active involvement, cooperation, and coordination by all concerned. Thank you, Ms. Sapna Chhabria, ma'am, for working day in and out to make this webinar a successful one. My kind appreciation to all the SYDLH student volunteers who work tirelessly. Alam Alia, Inshira Sheikh, Ankita Jain, Sadav Jait Purwala, Kiran Shah, Saima Motarwala, Sahima Memon, and Arfia Pavaskar, Hafsa Multani, Heenal Darji. Last but not the least, I would like to thank the wonderful audience to stay connected with us all throughout the session. I request all participants to kindly fill the feedback form. Now, I kindly request everyone to rise for the national anthem.
Inshira?
Yes, ma'am.
Is there a problem playing audio?
Yes, ma'am. It is on, but computers, the voice is not coming.
Okay, never mind.
Ma'am, it is starting.
Okay, please start.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, we can do this. We can all sing together. I will request, all the audience and everyone.